So at ST Microelectronics, we use the LLVM compiler to build a compiler for our proprietary processor, and we also have our own port for the ARM processor. And I will detail in this presentation what we have implemented in this compiler to add some protections to applications against fault attacks. So we are moving from a world where we had a few dedicated circuits with embedded security features to a very highly connected world with IoT nodes, with constraints on power, on cryptography and confidentiality. It's expected to have about 20 billion of nodes in 2020 and in every aspect of our everyday life. So these circuits can be a subject of physical attacks. So either with side channel attacks, so this is an observation with the timing of the execution of an algorithm, or with power analysis and electromagnetic signature of the circuit during its executions. There can be also some physical attacks with a laser pulse, with an electromagnetic pulse also, and with clock or power glitches. And these attacks, the objectives are to obtain sensitive data, or to bypass some protections, or to reverse engineering the code. So to protect against these attacks, there are the possibility to develop some countermeasure in software. So it can be done at the source level. So it's easy to implement, but the compiler tends to remove them. So it's it requires some tweaks when doing the implementations, and or sometimes we have to demote some optimizations, but it results in poor quality of the code, of the final code. The other approach is to implement the countermeasure at the assembly level. But the code is highly transformed and very efficient at this level, so it's difficult to map the original code to the assembly code, and there may be very few free resources to implement this countermeasure. This countermeasure, the objective is to protect the code against an instruction skip or modification of an instruction or data. So our idea is to implement these protections inside the compiler instead of inside the application or in the assembly code. And in this way, we don't have to struggle with the compiler, because we can do the transformation in the compiler, and the compiler will not remove these transformations. And also, these transformations that we added in the code inside the compiler will be efficiently generated. They are part of the final code, and they will be efficiently transformed during the logical allocation and the instruction scheduling. So we based our implementation on a research paper. The first one is a paper from 2002. And it proposed to duplicate the instruction with the use of different registers, to duplicate also the memory, and to have some checks at synchronization points. And in 2005, there was another paper based on the first one. The objective was to reduce the performance and code size impact of this transformation, and also to add some control flow checking capabilities. So this paper, this quantum measure, so we address a single fault on an instruction. So protection is guaranteed if the whole program is protected, and the memory is outside of the scope of these protections. So since the paper was named Swift, our implementation is named Secure Swift, and we call it SecSwift inside the LLVM compiler. And we only do an abort, an error detection. We don't support an error recovery. So we have separated our implementation in three parts, which can be activated separately and they combine each other. So there is a duplication of instructions. There is a modification of the ABI to duplicate the parameters and to duplicate the return value. And there is the control flow integrated checking part where we can check the correct execution of branch and also on the call and return instructions. This is based on the signature which is propagated along control flow edges. And there is also, and at some synchronization points, we check the validity of the signature. So I will go through these three points in detail. So the first point is the duplication of instructions. So this is implemented at the intermediate representation of the LLVM compiler, so in the middle end. So we duplicate instruction and we add some verifications at synchronization points. And this control measure is the objective is to prevent. Is to detect a skip of an instruction. So since we do this duplication inside the compiler will not remove the duplicated instructions, and for this we use intrinsic functions and pseudo operators to hide a copy. And also the code will be fully optimized by the register allocation and the code scheduling. There still remains some code that is not protected because our implementation is at the middle end level. So there is some code that is generated later in the backend and notably for the prologue epilogue instruction. So these instructions are not protected currently by our implementation. So the second part is the modification of the ABI. So we just duplicate the parameter, and we also duplicate the return value. To do this, we have to create a new function, which with the name prefix with SecSwift. At the end of the SecSwift passes, we run a dead code function elimination to remove the function which are never called. The third point is on the control flow checking. Here again, it's again an instruction skip to protect the code against an instruction skip and also on an error on the branch instructions. This is based on the property of the XOR operator. And we use two variables, general signature register, which contains the signature of the currently executing basic block, and a runtime transfer signature, which is built at the end of a basic block, and it contains an XOR between the current signature and the signature of the destination block. On the left side, you have the representation at the control flow graph level. On the right side, you have a representation at the pseudo C code level. The XOR operator has been chosen instead of add or remove operations because of its properties and because of its hardware implementation, which has less surface for an attack. And the combination of the GSR and RTS variables allows to, if there is an error because the instruction is not executed or there is a corruption on the value of the GSR or RTS variables, the error will be propagated along the computations, the update of this GSR variable. And so we don't need to insert assertions at every update of the GSR variable. We only need to put the assertions at some synchronization points, and notably when there is an operation with a side effect. And so we can see the GSR variable as a redundant, as a copy of the program counter. So we extended this control flow checking at the basic block level to control flow checking at the call graph level. So for this, we defined two signatures for our functions. These signatures are based on the function name by a hash function. And so we define a signature for the entry of the function and a signature for the exit points of the function so that we can check that the whole body of the function has been executed and not we don't leave the function before the end of its execution. And so the IP GSR and IP RTS value are passed as two additional parameters. So SecSwitch has been implemented at the LLVM IR level in two generic passes, so module passes for the ABI and IP-CFG transformation, and as the function passes for the duplication and control flow graph integrity checking within the basic blocks. And we added these two passes at the very end of the sequences of passes in the middle end of the compiler, because such that the optimization are not affected by our transformations. And we also added a pass of dead function elimination after the SecSwitch passes. We also have some modification in the target backend, but very limited because we use some intrinsic function and pseudo instructions. We have to lower them before the register allocation, and we also have to correctly generate the code for the duplicated return value. So these transformations are done in the target backend. So SecSwitch can be implemented by as four different modules: the duplications of instructions, the control flow graph integrity, the interprocedural control flow graph integrity, and the modification of the ABI. So we have command line options which apply to all the functions of a file. We also added some attributes which overrides the command line options. So this allows to apply these transformation locally to a function. And at the end, we also implemented it through Pragma. So the Pragma applies to the next instruction, so to the next block of instructions. And so we can ask for the dupe or CFG options to apply on these instructions. And to implement this, we reused the OpenMP captured feature. So the instruction or block of instruction are outlined in a function. We put the SecSwitch attributes on this function to tell the compiler which transformation, which SecSwitch transformations must be applied to this function. And then we run the SecSwitch transformations as we do on other functions. And at the end, these outline functions are re-inlined into the original function. And this way, we can have efficient code produced which is protected inside a function. And we also use the LLVM function attributes to pass the C-Lang options to the LLVM because we want to compile in the LTO mode. So and we need this information to and so we have completely validated the code in minus F LTO option. So how is the code more robust after this transformation? So historically, before the compiler was able to generate such code, security expert would analyze the code after generation and check that the code contains the countermeasure which have been implemented at the source level. And so now that the countermeasures are implemented in the compiler must be part of the certification process. And we also need more tools to verify the generated code, the robustness of the protections at the end. So we would need a simulator with fault injection capabilities, but we can use some simpler solution based on debugger tools, and this is how we did currently. And for example, on a very simple code which just compared to strings. When it's compiled at minus O2, it generates 15 ARM instructions, and there is so we do a skip of each instructions individually. So there is a 30% successful attacks. If we add the dub features, we have now 53 instructions with a rate of 7% of successful attacks. And then if we combine all the SegSwift transformations, we can have no attacks can be successful, no skip of instruction attack can be successful on this code. So we also measure how much for this, so in terms of code size and performance. So we did the measurements of on a Cortex M0 processor at minus OZ minus FLTO. So we have our set of benchmark to qualify our compiler. So we used this set of benchmarks. So on performance, it's about 2 times slower, and the major contributor is the duplication of instructions, and the code is 50% slower when CFG and IPCFG are applied alone. And on the code side impact, it's 3 times larger. Here again, it's a duplication of instructions, which is the most contributor. And CFG and IPCFG also increase the code a lot. But when we have an application, so not the whole application need to be protected by these countermeasure, only some parts of the application where there is a crypto algorithm or where there is some licensing checking, we only need to protect this part. And since we have the function attribute and the pragma instructions, we can very finely tune the scope of the transformations. Since in some cases developers compile the application in minus O0 to avoid the compiler to remove the software countermeasure, the minus O0 code is about the same size of the code compiled with SegSwift features. So it's a continuous race between countermeasure and between attackers, because now attacks are more and more precise in terms of timing and in terms of location on the chips when there is a laser pulse. And now there can also be some synchronized attacks, so it's more and more difficult to protect the code against these attacks. So the protections, so we have to extend our protections, and some ideas are to introduce some dead code and so to introduce some randomization in the generated code. And at ST, we also run this code on hardware which contains some protections. So we need both protections to have an application robust. In conclusion, so we cannot continue with manually implemented software protections because attacks are more and more sophisticated. The countermeasure which we need to implement are more and more complex, and we need to deliver our product very quickly. So we need a tool which we have implemented to increase the productivity, to have some control and the best possible control on the code we generate. We also must be able to compile arbitrary code bases, and this transformation must compose well together, and they must be robust. And so the security experts may see their role move, because they now will have to propose a new countermeasure to be implemented in the compiler, and they probably will have to validate the compiler more than the final application code, and they will also need to locate correctly in the application which parts of the application need to be protected. And thank you.
Thank you, François. Do we have questions?
Hi, thank you for the presentation. Can you elaborate a bit on the power impact on these changes?
Excuse me.
And so the power consumption impact. And you know if you're introducing any side channel attacks with that in us?
Yeah, you have no idea on the power consumption consequences of no. Since we use the an emulator to do these measurements, I don't have a real hardware measure.
Thank you. Can you tell us a little bit more about how you measure the percentage of attacks that were successful or not? Are these attacks generated or?
It's just a count of well, for example, if I. I think. There was 15 instructions in the -02 case, and we just did a skip of each instruction individually, and we count the number of successful attacks. So probably to reach a 13% successful attack, we probably had about 3 or 4 instruction skip that was successful. Does this answer your question?
Hi. You were saying about how for interprocedural protection you add a couple of function parameters based on a hash of the function name. How would you scale that to function pointers?
This is something we are working on, but it's not currently implemented, and we have some ideas. Under implementation.
Okay.
And in the same line, how do you protect against interrupts? Do you cover interrupts?
No. currently interrupts are not covered. Yes, we don't support C++ code currently.
It's for embedded code, yes.
Yeah.
Hello, I have a question. We have presented this idea to some industries about using a compiler to protect against such changes. I think they told us that they don't want to change their compiler because they know which code you will generate, the code size you will generate, all this stuff. So my question is, do you manage to have people in SUM Electronics use this in production, or is it still at the research stage?
It's in production inside ST, but it won't be distributed outside ST. Is that your question?
Basically, yeah. Okay, thanks.
Okay, I had a question. As far as I understood, the protections cover mostly the instruction path, but the duplication may have an impact on the data as well. You have also an assumption about the fact that you use ECC memory, which may bring some level of security, level of robustness against faults.
Yeah.
What about the internal memory, the in-processor memory, say L1 or SRAM?
I think maybe there are some hardware mechanism which are there in our applications to protect our IoT nodes, which are there to protect this path, which out of the scope of the software protections.
Okay, thank you. Okay, so if there are no more questions, I suggest that we move to the next speaker.